CobraNet is a licensed technology from a company named Cirrus Logic, and it allows uncompressed digital audio to travel across standard network cables and switches. There are several manufacturers beyond Harman which have CobraNet-enabled products. Since all of them are forced to pay significant licensing fees per CobraNet-enabled product, CobraNet tends to be a relatively expensive technology regardless of the manufacturer. CobraNet uses a physical infrastructure which follows the same rules as standard 100 megabit Ethernet. Therefore, it works with Cat5 or better cables, which can be up to 100 meters in length or further on fiber optic cables. CobraNet works with virtually any 100 megabit or better network switch, be it managed or unmanaged, although managed switches are generally recommended for anything beyond a very small system. CobraNet traffic can coexist with other traffic on a network, but it's generally recommended to isolate CobraNet traffic either physically using separate switches and cables, or logically using VLANs configured on managed switches. Otherwise, if there are bursts of non-CobraNet traffic, such as large file transfers between computers, this will steal network bandwidth and cause dropouts in the audio. And conversely, CobraNet traffic itself, for reasons I'll explain shortly, can be harmful to other traffic on a mixed-use network. The maximum input-output capacity per CobraNet device is 32 by 32, meaning one device can send and receive 32 channels of CobraNet audio in both directions simultaneously over the same Cat5 cable. These channels get subdivided into groups called bundles, which contain up to 8 channels each. Therefore, there are 4 incoming bundles and 4 outgoing bundles per device. There are 2 settings which determine the number of channels you can squeeze into a bundle: sample rate and bit depth. As you increase these 2 settings, you decrease the number of channels per bundle. With any form of networked audio, it's always important to understand the distinction between a device limitation and the network limitation. 32 by 32 is the limitation per device, not per network. The total network limitation for CobraNet is essentially the size of the network. For example, a single network might have hundreds or even thousands of CobraNet channels streaming through it, any of which can be routed to any single device, just no more than 32 simultaneously to that device. CobraNet has 3 latency settings: 5.3 milliseconds, 2.6 milliseconds, and 1.3 milliseconds. Let's say a mic is connected to an analog input on a CobraNet-enabled device, such as a BSS Audio Soundweb London Blue 800. And let's say the mic needs to reach a speaker, which is connected to an output on a CobraNet-enabled amplifier, such as a Crown CTS 8200. Assuming both devices are set to 5.3 milliseconds, this means the signal will play out from the CobraNet module within the amplifier 5.3 milliseconds after exiting the Blue 800's CobraNet module. As long as there aren't too many network switches in the signal chain. Here are some general guidelines. When using the 5.3 milliseconds setting, you should have no more than 7 network switches between the transmitting device and the receiving device. With the 2.6 millisecond setting, you should have no more than 3. And with 1.3 milliseconds, you should have no more than 1 switch in between. So basically, the fewer the switches, the lower the latency value you can safely choose. Nearly all CobraNet-enabled products have a primary and a secondary port, which is useful for redundancy applications. CobraNet redundancy is based on a cable's proper physical connection to these ports. In other words, it's based on port link. Even if both ports have link, only the primary port is active. The secondary port doesn't send or receive anything. If the primary port loses link, then the secondary port becomes active. So you can connect both ports to the same switch for cable fault tolerance, or ideally, connect them to separate switches to also achieve switch fault tolerance. just make sure the switches are connected together. Otherwise, you might send traffic to a secondary port on a device which is inactive due to link on the primary port. To send CobraNet audio from one device to another, the two devices must use matching CobraNet bundle numbers. A bundle number can be any number from 1 through 65,279. Numbers 1 through 255 are reserved for multicast bundles, which create broadcast transmissions to all devices on the network. And numbers 256 and above are reserved for unicast bundles, which create point-to-point transmissions. Let's say 8 mics are connected to a Blue 800, and they need to reach 8 speakers connected to a CTS 8200. We'll assume the bit depth and sample rate settings on both devices allow for 8 channels per bundle, which means we only need to set up one bundle. If we choose a multicast bundle number, such as 100, then the 8 mics will reach the amp as desired. But undesirably, they'll also transmit to all other devices on the network. Therefore, multicast bundles should always be avoided if possible, because it doesn't take many of them to overwhelm and crash a network. Bringing down an entire network is never a good thing, and it's even worse if you've thrown caution to the wind by running CobraNet through a building's main network. So in this case, a unicast bundle, for example, 300, would certainly be a better choice. But now let's say the 8 mics need to reach 4 amplifiers. You might be thinking, well, we have to use multicast, but there's actually a third and final type of bundle, multi-unicast. A multi-unicast bundle is simply a unicast bundle whose max number of receivers property is set to 2, 3, or 4. In other words, unicast is 1-to-1, multi-unicast is 1-to-4 max, and multicast is 1-to-all. So in this case, we can still avoid multicast by using multi-unicast. If we change max number of receivers to 4, then all 4 amps can successfully receive bundle 300. However, if 5 devices need to receive the same bundle, then multicast might be necessary, although there are still some clever workarounds for avoiding multicast, but that's really beyond the scope of this video. For more information on CobraNet, please visit this website. Next, let's take a detailed look at BlueLink.